Hello, my dear first PUC students. Welcome to Kingdom Animalia, Chapter 4, Session 16. Let me share the screen and start today's class. Dear students, if you recall, in my previous class, I did three classes, class Cyclostomata, Chondrichthyes, and Osteichthyes. All the three were interrelated with some general characters, so we completed that three classes in a single session. In today's session, we are going to complete two classes, namely class Amphibia and class Reptilia. Why? Because the general characters what we are going to discuss now are already discussed. Most of the points are already discussed in our previous 15 sessions. So the class speed may go little faster today. Okay. If at all, if you get any doubt or if any confusion, you can just go back to any other previous sessions and you can get your doubt cleared. Okay. So class Amphibia. So whenever Amphibia word comes, we always keep frog in mind, isn't it? So keeping frog in mind, we will study the general characters, and if any other examples are there, I will show you the photograph. Class Amphibia. Amphibia means, the definition what I usually get from student is the animals which can live both on land and water, both on land and water. That is the definition here in first point you can see. Dear students, when we speak about class Amphibia, frog will come to our mind. That is a standard example what we have studied in our school days, isn't it? So now, and also you will be knowing the definition. Whenever I ask a definition in classrooms, students will tell, organisms which can live both on land and water, which can live both on land and water. See the first point in general characters now. They can live both in aquatic and terrestrial habitat or environment. So slightly a standard sentence. Once again, they can live, that's what the word. They can live both in aquatic land and, sorry, water and land. That's what it is emphasizing now. Amphibia word is actually derived from a Greek term, amphi means dwell, bios means life. So two habitats. Yeah, you are right. The definition is also same as you have said, but according to me as a biology lecturer, I just want to modify the thought of definition in your mind. Amphibia means the organisms which can live, no, which should, which must require both land and water to complete its life cycle is called as amphibians. The organisms which require, which compulsorily requires water as well as land to complete its life cycle is the correct meaning of amphibia according to biology. But as I said, we are sticking onto the textbook. You can stick onto the definition what is there in front of you now. But change the meaning in your mind, change the thought in your mind. These are the organisms which require both land and water to complete its life cycle. That's why they are called as amphibians. Or else we would have found numerous species of amphibians in desert. We don't find amphibians in desert, right? Because to lay egg, to continue its larval stage, that is tadpole larva, it requires water. So that is the actual meaning, but we will stick on to the textbook information. They can live both on land and water. And the name meaning dual environment. Most of them have two pairs of limbs. If you take frog, it is having two pairs of limbs, four limbs and hind limbs. So that is a common point you have come across. Body will be divisible into head and trunk. Head, trunk. No tail. Okay, no tail will be there. And if at all tail is there, there are some limbless amphibians and urodils, means salamander. I just want to show you the example. See this one. If you take this one, this is salamander, the black one here. This is salamander. This is having two pairs of limbs here, four limbs and hind limbs. And you have to, and the above one is a frog. This is also having two pairs of limbs. This side it is clear for you, four limb and hind limb. And the speciality of this amphibians is, though they are having two pairs of limb, in each limb it will be having only four number of fingers. Digits we call. Nalakku berulugalu irutthade. Four limbalu ashte, hind limbalu ashte. Nalakku berulugalu irutthade. Body is divisible into head and trunk, I said. And tail is present in some of the amphibians, as we saw. In salamander, tail is there. So not all the amphibians will be having tail, bala. Their skin is moist. It was a very important 1 mark question 2 years back, I believe. The skin of amphibian is moist. That was the, that's what the question they had asked. Give reason, because the, it is devoid of scales, or scales are absent. They do not have scales was the point. ಅದ್ರ ಮೈ ಮೇಲೆ ಫಿಶಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರೋ ತರ ಸ್ಕೇಲ್ಸ್ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದರಿಂದ ಅದರದು ಬಾಡಿ ಸ್ಕಿನ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಮಾಯಿಸ್ಟ್, ಮ್ಯೂಕಸ್ ತರ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಓಕೆ, ಅಂಡ್ ಸ್ಪೀಕಿಂಗ್ ಆನ್ ಟು ದಿ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್, ದೇರ್ ಐಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಐ ಲಿಡ್ಸ್. ಐ ಲಿಡ್ಸ್ ಇದು ಕವರ್. ಓಕೆ, ದ ಕವರ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಐಸ್, ದ ಐಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್, ದರ್ ಐಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಐ ಲಿಡ್ಸ್. Ears, kivigalu. Ears are represented by tympanum. This is also a very important point. Ears, if you see me on the screen, ears will be not having this type of opening. It will be covered by skin like this, fully covered by skin like this, like a drum. Okay, don't confuse it with the eardrum now. I will show you the photo now. See here, this one, this photograph you see. Tympanum word, I think you can locate here. Can you see a round structure similar to the size of a ear? Ear also it is there. Ear also I will draw now. This one. That is called as tympanum. It detects the sound waves whenever it requires. Okay. Ears are represented by tympanum. Very important point. Elementary canal, the digestive tract that is running from mouth to anus, the tube that runs from mouth to anus. Okay, elementary canal, that is digestive system, urinary system, okay, the kidney related, okay, kidney, urinary system, and reproductive system. Three system: digestive system, urinary system, and reproductive system. All these three have a single opening. ಈ ಮೂರುಕ್ಕೂ ಒಂದೇ ಒಂದು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೀರಿಯರ್ ಹೋಗೋಕೆ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಆ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ನೇಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಕ್ಲೋಯೆಕಾ. ಡೈಜೆಸ್ಟಿವ್ ಟ್ರ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್, ರೀಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಟ್ರ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯೂರಿನರಿ ಟ್ರ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್, ಆಲ್ ದ ತ್ರೀ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ಟು ದಿ ಔಟ್ ಸೈಡ್, ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಕ್ಲೋಯೆಕಾ. ದಿಸ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ನಂಬರ್ 7 and 8 ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ರಿಪೀಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ. Okay, you know what is tympanum now? It is the structure which is covered over the ear, structure which is covered by the skin. Cloaca is a common opening for three, that is digestive tract, urinary tract, and reproductive tract. I have collected a photo, you can just see this one. Now if you see the green color structure here, this is the digestive system. Now you can see this pink color structure. Okay, pink color structure, I label it as reproductive system. It can be ovary or a testis. And this you can see urinary system, urinary bladder it is. If you see all these three, from digestive system, you see digestive system also is coming to this opening called as cloaca. From this testis and ovary also it is coming and getting opening here, and finally from urinary bladder also it is coming and opening in this same chamber. That chamber is called as cloacal chamber, and the opening is called as cloaca. The same logic is applied in the next class also, that is in class Reptilia. There I may not be showing you this diagram. This is just to make you understand how all the three system is using a single opening called as cloaca to open, to eliminate, or to throw the things outside, or to release the eggs outside, or to release the sperm outside. Now looking on to the next 9th point, respiration occurs through gills when during their larval stage. Larva, as I said, it totally looks like a fish, isn't it? Where we were like this one, when you see this young one, see egg stage and embryo, this is tadpole larva. Larva, see here, this is aquatic form, tail is in aquatic form, all. So they will be having gills for respiration. So three type of respiratory structures are there: So larva is common for all the amphibians. All the amphibians, ella amphibians larval stage na naavu tadpole larva antane karitivi. Okay na? So larva ge respiratory structure banbitu gills, and once it becomes adult, lung also will be there. When it is on the land, terrestrial habitat alli iddaga lungina mukantara adu usiraadutte. And it also, whenever frogs also undergoes winter sleep, hibernation and summer sleep, anta time alli illa neeralli irbekare it can also breathe through the skin. Skinina mukantara kuda it can breathe. Okay, so that's why the respiration is called as cutaneous. Skin respiration is called as cutaneous. Lung respiration, maybe in theory class, in next topic I will be teaching you, lung respiration is called as pulmonary respiration, and cutaneous respiration also will happen. So collectively the adults will show a type of respiration, clubbed word, pulmocutaneous. Pulmocutaneous respiration is seen in the adult. So this we will be studying in detail when we study frog type study. Here you need to mention respiration will happen through gills, lung and skin. Enough. Understood? That cutaneous word they may ask, okay, what is the type of respiration when it is through the skin? So that is an important point. Heart is three chambered. In previous class only we started about heart, right? So heart was two chambered in case of fishes. Now advanced, three chambered. So next actually we have to expect four chamber, we'll see, and not five chamber. Okay, four chamber is the ultimate. So heart is three chambered. That's what we are not going to draw the diagram nor explain in detail. Amphibians have a three chambered heart. Done. Sexes are separate. Male is separate and female is separate. They are not hermaphrodites. Female are almost in chordates. When you come phylum chordata, subphylum vertebrata, all of them have male separate and female separate. So this is not a special or unique important point. Fertilization is external. Actually external fertilization was there even in the fishes, but in chondrichthyes, shark and all, we were like seeing internal fertilization, and in other ostrichthyes and other fishes we saw external fertilization. Here also in frog, what happens? External fertilization happens here. So frog sits like this and it will release the eggs in the water. Female, okay, they release eggs in the water, and male will release sperms in the water. These sperms and egg gets fertilized and they form zygote, and then they form embryo, and then they hatch out as tadpole larva. So the fertilization here you have to just mention it is external fertilization in case of amphibians, and they are egg laying. Oviparous means what? I have mentioned 2-3 times in my previous class I have mentioned it. Oviparous is the word which means egg laying. And the last one, development is indirect. Development means indirect. So whenever indirect development we speak about, that means the development or the metamorphosis includes larval stages, and the larval stage name of amphibia is tadpole larva. That is also an important point. Okay, now speaking about the examples, toad is the one which looks exactly like a frog near your house and all. It will be brownish in color, brown color irutade kappe kappe ante heltivi. That is not actually the frog, it is toad. Frog, tree frog, salamander. See, this is salamander, the black one. So there are brightly colored amphibians. Okay, so many amphibians are there, but we are not going to draw any diagram here while speaking about class amphibia general characters. We are just mentioning the examples and just looking into the photograph. Okay, hope amphibia class is clear to you. If at all you are having any doubt, go through this another 10 to 15 minutes back, go through it again and again. Most of the points we have already discussed, and I hope you don't get any of the doubt. If at all there is any doubt, write the points, Okay, write the points. So this is the general characters which is there in your textbook. You can take a screenshot and write in your notes. Don't simply copy, just you can write at least four points without seeing, right? So you can copy. This is the prescribed points in your textbook, so you have to stick on. Got it? I'm moving to the next part. So these are the examples. So these are the heart's anatomy. So this was a fish heart. If you see, it was two chambered. Okay, this was something like first chamber and second chamber. And when it comes to amphibia, you can see one ventricle, two auricle. Now, when it comes to reptile, you can see there is a formation of two ventricles, but this ventricle chamber is not formed. We'll come to this heart diagram later. So in amphibia, we know that it is having one ventricle and two auricles. One ventricle and two auricles. Once again, this diagram is not required. Just to show you, I have taken this image. Class Reptilia, general characters. Reptilia in Greek refers to creeping or crawl. Creeping. See my hand? Itara. Snake move agar nodidire. Have you seen a snake moving? Okay. You can take a snake. You can take a crocodile. Crocodile is a reptile. You can take lizards in your house. Now, you can take elephant. Elephant is not a reptilia. You can take a dog. Dog and elephant are mammals. See, dog is having four legs, isn't it? Four number of legs. Elephant is having four legs. Crocodile is also having four legs. Palli or the gecko or the house lizard is also having four legs. But even though they are all having four limbs, four legs, see the movement. Reptiles will show this movement, a zigzag type of movement, creep or crawl. But elephant and dog, you see, they move straight in a single line. So that's why I gave you the example of dog and elephant, but dog and elephant belongs to mammalia. So hence they creep, crawl. The name comes reptilia because they show creeping and crawling type of locomotion. Hope the first point is clear. That is the meaning of reptilia. They are mostly terrestrial. See, keep one thing in mind. They have not mentioned it strongly, but I'm telling you strongly. Reptilians are the first class of chordates or vertebrates to live independently on land. They can live independently on land. They need not require water for their life cycle. For example, there are some animals secondarily adapted for aquatic mode of life. So turtles, crocodile and all, they are in water, but they do not require any water for their larval stage or something like that, because they will be having direct development from now onwards. So reptilians are the first true land vertebrates, I can tell. And most, if you see lizards, monitor lizards and all, which live in desert, they don't require any water. They lay eggs in soil only. So even the geckos, palligalu, or the house lizard, chameleon, garden lizard and all, if you take, they don't require any water. So aquatic reptilians like crocodiles and turtles, etc., they are secondarily adapted for aquatic mode of life. So to be clear, from my side, I can tell you that the true first land vertebrates. Understood? So they are mostly terrestrial. Most of them are terrestrial, that's what. Majority. Their body is covered by dry and cornified skin called as epidermal scales and scutes. This is an important point. This is an important point. I collected the photo of that epidermal scales and scute. See, this you can see. The first one is a crocodile one. The one on the skin which is sharp, bony-like structure, horn-like structure. Can you see here? Okay. Here is breaking and this is the broken piece. So these sharp, hard structures on crocodiles, okay, even it is present on other reptiles also. Crocodiles, most of you know, so I am telling crocodile. So these structure, hard horn like structure, are called as epidermal scutes. A very important question from the examination point of view and in practicals in Viva. Okay, one word answer only, but you have to remember. And you see here enlarged view of snake. You can see scales here. Okay, they are also dry and dead. Okay, dry and dead. And here also you can see a lizard. I kept iguana. Okay, so here I want to concentrate this region, a circle I am making. That is nothing but tympanum, what we spoke in amphibia. So here also tympanum is there. We will be coming across that point. So third point is clear, I believe, cornified skin, epidermal scales and scutes. So they are all external epidermal covering protection on the body. They do not have external ear opening, same point as of amphibia. Ear is represented by tympanum. Here also the same repetition of point. Fourth point. Coming on to fifth point. Again, this point is repeated from amphibia and ear. Two pairs of limbs are there. There also in salamander and frog we saw two pairs of limbs. Yerad kai, yerad kaal onta. Kai irala, but still. Here also crocodile, turtle and all you see. But the difference is there, the four limb, kai galu onta enertivi. The four limb will be having four fingers. Four digits we call. And hind limbs, legs, what frogs had, they were having five digits, five fingers. Fingers, what is actually wrong to use, but still I'll use now. But when it comes to reptilia, garden lizard, crocodile and all, if you see, whichever is having two pairs of limbs, they are having five plus five digits, both in four limbs, hands, as well as legs, they will be having five plus five fingers and ending up with claws, ugrutara. But there is no claws in amphibia. Okay. Moving on to the next point. Heart is usually three chambered, somewhat like amphibians only, except in crocodile, they say. Crocodile is having four chambered, they will tell, but that is not truly four chambered. Mark that sentence in your mind. Crocodile alli fully four chambered heart form agiralla. See, this is the reptile, this actually I wanted to show. This is a crocodile one. See, right side bird you see, taking off, this one you see. One, two, these are ventricles. Three, four, auricles. Clear chamber is there. Can you see this chamber wall? I'm drawing it overwriting on that one. And it is exactly same in human, mammals also. So these both are same. But here you see in ventricle region, this wall is not fully formed. E wall illi tanka band complete agilla. So the wall is not fully formed. So it is incomplete only. So reptiles have three chambered heart except crocodile. Crocodile starts the formation of division of this ventricle, but the ventricle is not fully divided in case of crocodile. Arthaktidya, even if it is fully technically speaking, this is for degree students. Okay, even the chamber is fully completed there is mixing up of blood in crocodile. Understood? But crocodile also, you cannot tell it is completely four chambered. That is biologically wrong. So you just mentioned the reptiles have three chambered heart, except crocodile, they have four chambered heart, but that is not exactly true. But according to your POC, this information is enough. They are poikilothermous. In previous amphibians, this point was not there, so don't think that is not included. Both amphibians and now reptilians, both are poikilothermous. What does it mean? That other English term we said, cold-blooded. Don't use this word. Better you use poikilotherms. That is a standard word and it will help you in your higher studies also, poikilotherms. That means what? The temperature of the body fluctuates along with the ambient temperature, the surrounding temperature. If the surrounding temperature is 18 degree, their body temperature also will be 18 degree. If the external temperature is 25 degree, their body also will be having 25 degree temperature. So that's what the meaning, poikilothermous. And we are not explaining the definition here. Definition we studied in fishes. And if at all they ask a direct question, you have to write the definition for that one. Snakes and lizards shed their scales as skin cast. Snakes, you know, they remove their skin covering. Because as we said, the skin covering is actually dead and cornified. Dead layer, it will be protecting it. And as the animal grows, that will not be elastic. So what happens? It will remove the outer covering and it will develop the new covering that is easily seen in snakes. Most of you have come across in snakes, at least in movies or National Geography or somewhere we are in real life, we have seen the external covering of snake, which is cast off, remove off. How pore bichodon teltarala adun. Okay. So actually that name I mentioned you in phylum Arthropoda, if you recall. Okay. There, here also they would have mentioned the biological term for that one. That is called as moulting, M-O-U-L-T-I-N-G. Moulting, or it is also called as ecdysis. Hence, they have not mentioned these two terms. I too don't want you to write. But as a biology student, you should be knowing, because it may be helpful for you to write in CET or NEET or in IR degree classes if you take up biology in as a major subject. Okay, snakes and lizards shed their external scales as skin casts. So all these are very important points, dear students. Almost all the points. Sexes are separate. Once again, here male is separate and female is separate. They are not hermaphrodites. As I said, from fishes only there will be no. All the vertebrates are having sexes separated. Males and females are separate. So that's not a very important unique point, but you have to mention. Fertilization is internal. The male will release the semen or the gametes into the female reproductive tract. Inside the female reproductive tract, fertilization happens. It is internal fertilization, and then almost all the reptiles are oviparous. They lay eggs. Okay, fertilization is internal. I'll mention they are also oviparous. Means what? Egg laying. Some points are not mentioned in the textbook. No problem, but it's not like that. It is not important or something like that. It is understood. That's why they have left some points. So fertilization is internal, and they are oviparous in nature. They lay the eggs. And finally, development is direct. As I said, a snake egg, when it hatches out, there you find small snake. Crocodile egg, when it hatches out, you find small crocodiles. So they are the miniature of adults, but they are not sexually matured. Small in size and no sexual maturity will be seen. That is what we call it as direct development. See, examples, if you see, they have split the examples if you see in the study material or textbook. Example, any snake example you can write, snake, lizard, etc. And they will also ask, mention one or two example for poisonous snake. It is their Naga, it is the Indian cobra, Nagrahu, Bangarus, Krait, Viper. And some students, when I see in the answer paper, they write some their general knowledge answer, Black Mamba, some other names, even I too don't know. Don't take a risk of writing the examples, what you know and what teachers don't know. Understood? If they stick on to the textbook answers, they may give you wrong sometimes. You will be the losers. So one or two examples, easy examples are given in the textbook. So do stick on to the examples, what is there in the textbook, and mention the same examples. If at all, there is a direct question when it is asked. Understood? So this is class Reptilia. We are having 11 important points. So dear students, you can just pause and take a screenshot of this slide. Till today, I have said there is no diagram for you to learn. So only general characters and few common examples with common names. So I am signing off from today's session, session 16, chapter 4, Kingdom Animalia. Take care and study well.